moments there for Scotland and some of the key personnel as well as pundits having their say on them. And you did touch on it a little bit already, bearing in mind England do face Scotland in their Euro group. How wary should everyone within that group be of Scotland, do you think?
Well, Scotland have suffered enormously over the last, you know, just look at the tournaments they qualified. It's hardly any over the last quarter of a century.
First one since 1998.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's 20 plus years since they've made it. And they've not been a good side. I've always felt England are always the number one team. And then sometimes Republic of Ireland would be the second and maybe Wales. And then they've sort of flipped positions. Mm. Northern Ireland done brilliantly. And Scotland were in a bit of a lull. And I think they've got a really good side now, a much improved side. I think McGinn and McTominay in midfield, and they didn't play in midweek, you know, as in starting the team. But Stuart
against
Armstrong
the
against
yeah.
the Netherlands, 2-2 draw, defended brilliantly. He played a back three. Tierney of the left of the three did really well. I mean, he's still going to be tested by teams that might want to try and expose or exploit the positions behind that three. Andy Robertson made a great goal for Nesbitt, a great cross, kept surging, making surging runs. So there's a lot of good things about Scotland and against a decent Dutch side. You know, got a lot of good, but Memphis Depay was just superb, just superb.
I want to ask you about Memphis Depay in a moment, but just focusing on Scotland then, when you look at their squad, I mean, they've got, there's no denying they've got pedigree now in their squad. They've got massive experience. You mentioned Andy Robertson, their captain. They've got Tierney, Scott McTominay, John McGinn, Liam Cooper, obviously, who is the Leeds captain, and Marcelo Bielsa reveres him.
Stuart Armstrong, you know.
They've got names. And then they've got, you know, obviously Billy Gilmore, who's only just making his Scotland bow, but Che Adams, you know, he had a great sort of season for Southampton as well. So they've got some really interesting, impressive players in their squad that, if it all works out for them, could pay dividends.
Well, Steve Clark, who I was with at Chelsea, and, you know, Steve's a smart lad, and I think he's really gone for creating that, like he did at Kilmarnock, unity within the squad, overachieving, and he's got better players than he's had before. Look, Scotland are no well-beings. I'm not trying to say that this team are going to go and, you know, challenge the best in a tournament. What they'll do, they'll upset a few, and no one more than they'll try to do that against England, because it's quite clear Stevie Clark would love, you know, beating England is a big thing for the other nations. It's one of England's biggest obstacles that everyone around, from Ireland to Wales to Scotland, Northern Ireland, everybody is trying their socks off to beat England. Okay.
It's just that extra little bit of incentive, isn't it?
That incentive is always there when you play England.
But, I mean, is it though? Is it really?
Oh, absolutely.
And is it something that you can drive, that drives a team?
Yeah, and there is an element of Republic of Ireland. We didn't get beat for 20 years, didn't get beat by Ireland, by England. And we knew how good they were. We knew England had the best players. They had an incredible depth of talent, always. I mean, this is a great group now, but England have always had great groups. They've always had fantastic. You know, you go back years and you go, Shearer, Sheringham, Les Ferdinand and Andy Cole, and just the list went on. And then you go back an era before and you go, Gary Lineker, Peter Beardsley. You know, you just kept, all you do is keep naming great players in European football, you know. And they've had that at their disposal for years. I think England should have won three trophies, not one,
really?
Because they should have won Euro 96. Oh. They were clearly the best team in the tournament. I think Bobby Robson's team in 1990 that we played in the tournament were a really good side. Top players in there. I remember thinking, and we people forget that sometimes you're at clubs with England players. You know, I was at Aston Villa, and David Platt was in the England lineup at 90. So you're always close to some England players. Mm. Gordon Cowans was around at times. You know, so we knew how good they were, but that was definitely an incentive. But it's the same in the rugby. If you look at the rugby, England find it really difficult with the home nations. They're desperate to get one over England.
Well, it's interesting as well to get the thoughts of former England midfielder Paul Ince, who played against Scotland in Euro 96 in that well-known game, as we know. He's been speaking to talkSPORT's Ian Abrahams at the launch of Paddy Power's Fan Park, and he's told the Moose that this current Scotland side will cause England a lot of problems when they meet in Group D on the 18th of June.
As a coach or manager, you know, you need to get something from the first game, whether it's a point or 3 points. If you can do that, great. You know, if you don't, then you're under pressure to beat Scotland. you are on the bang under pressure to beat Scotland. And we always kind of think that we should beat Scotland with the kind of players that we've got, the squad that we've got. But it's never ever that way, because, you know, the Scots come with a lot of pride, you know, character, determination, will. They run, you know, a lot further than they would in a normal game because it's England versus Scotland. So, you know, people say, yeah, well, we've got the best players. You know, they're playing in the top leagues, in the Premier League, top teams, and don't pan out that way. You know, they've got a decent side, Scotland, and it'd be a tough game. But it's that rivalry again, isn't it? It's just like England-Scotland, and it's always going to be fiery. It's always going to be exciting, you know, and you know, hopefully we can get the right result.
Spot on.
But it's interesting. But isn't it interesting what he says as well there, which you've already mentioned with that first game for England against Croatia? If they don't get a result, the pressure that then heaps on Gareth Southgate and his team going into that Scotland game on June the 18th at Wembley will just be, well, heightened so much more.
Cranked up, yeah.
Yeah. And when you look at Scotland's fixtures, they start their campaign on June the 14th against the Czech Republic. And then, as I say, it's England at Wembley, followed by Croatia against Scotland at Hampden Park. Those two games, either side of the England game, are at Hampden Park with Scotland football fans in the ground. You know the atmosphere that they're going to create.
Yeah.
You know, you can imagine that we always talk about the 12th man. It will be a hugely significant 12th man for Scotland, no doubt. They haven't gone beyond a knockout round of a tournament in 67 years. Now, I know it's only been their first tournament since 1998, but yeah. Can you see them going through?
It's easier now than that, isn't it? I mean, the way the format, and, you know, you can qualify slightly easier, yeah?
Yes, I think not, because third place will have a chance.
Best third place, and it's, you know, I think Scotland would like to think they can get 4 points. Mm-hmm. Well, however way they get them, I think Steve would like to think 4 points might do us. And, you know, and it's a tough group, because one thing that England do lack is experience. I don't think there's a lot of it in that squad. No one doubts the quality of the players, because I don't. I think there's some tremendous players in their team that can cause any team in the world problems. But that is the one defining match. You know, the opening game of the season, I was chatting to Joe, our producer, in midweek. I said to him, do you know what? The amount that's surprising in the opening game, 88 euros, we beat England 1-0. Okay, in the 88 euros. Them surprise results, we beat Italy in World Cup 94 in the opening game of the tournament in the New York Giants Stadium. Now, these opening, they're everywhere. The Senegal beat France, you know, in the opening, you know, their opening group game. You know, these things happen quite regularly where we're coming off one scratching our head. And, you know, there's loads of fixtures like that have happened over the years where a really strong team has opened their group with a terrible result. And then it gets cranked up because of the pressure, because now you're really playing for your tournament in the second game. Imagine if England get beat by Croatia and they're playing for their tournament against Scotland in their second game to try and stay in.
And as you say, when you're talking about Croatia, the experience that they have, you know, there have been a few retirements since the World Cup semi-final, but they still have Luka Modric, for example.
Yeah, Brozovic in midfield, they've got Kovacic at Chelsea. That's their midfield. I mean, three of them are pretty decent. You know, they've still got Perisic still around, you know, Ribic. They've got some really good players, and a lot of players, like I said, over eight with more than 50 caps. So Croatia are going to certainly know what they're about. They might not be as good a team, but they might not need to be. You know, England, I still think that semi-final of the World Cup, Gareth got it wrong in the second half. They were leading the game and made changes that... And Croatia adapted to what England did. They made the wide areas more of a possibility of creating problems, and that's what they did, and England couldn't stop it. So, you know, these are close calls. These are good sides.